I like Himalaya. It's a beautiful terrain. And when you get into Himalaya, it tells you that, you know, you are such a small thing in this beautiful world. Whatever big you are in your city, you are a champion and whatever. But when you get into Himalaya, you're a small person. And you're running there. You're doing one of the cruelest marathon in the world. That's a great feeling. First challenge is the 50% oxygen. Second challenge is the temperature variations. -4 at night time and at the passes, and daytime it goes to 40 degrees.
Most of the races, they are generally at sea level or 3,000-4,000 kind of thing. This race starts at 11,000 feet. In addition to that, 10,000 feet is a tree line. About 10,000, there are no trees. So there are no shades.
Then the distance comes in the picture. So that's how all those aspects, it makes it the cruelest marathon in the world. Ultramarathon, according to me, is kind of a meditation. Basically, we need a lot of patience, and a person wants to know himself, he wants to understand himself. Ultramarathon is the best option, because where the regular marathon stops, like 42 kilometers is a regular marathon, and from there the ultramarathon starts, like 50, 75, 100, it can go on. According to me, it's not about the pace, it's about how can you sustain yourself, how long can you sustain yourself, how much can you push yourself, how can you challenge yourself. So it's a perfect way to understand yourself, your own body.
Of course, running anything above 50 kilometers is tough. It is very tough.
See, the difference between Ashish and a normal person, the way we walk, that is the way he runs. Like, if I tell you to go and walk for 2-3 kilometers, I'm sure you'll be able to manage it really easily. So for him, running 40-50 kilometers is just like that. Okay, because his body is adapted like that.
Ashish actually did Comrades in South Africa. Once he did that, actually that got him into these ultra marathons.
I did my 42 kilometer in Ladakh. There I saw Khardungla challenge. People were doing Khardung challenge, 72 kilometers. That attracted me. I said, "Hey, this is really nice. This is something bigger than 42. So I started enjoying that 42, 72, and then I did triple one. So it went off. But according to me, this is nasha. When your body has, like, you know, when you come back with your run and then there's soreness in your body. I just love that. That's a great feeling.
So the common things what people face apart from this dehydration and cramps is aches and pains in their knees, in their foot. But when you're doing those kind of distances, you start understanding your body really well. You definitely know, yeah, this is normal pain. I can bear it. Or then suddenly a sudden pain coming, which then the runner realizes, no, this is something not right. And sometimes you have to just switch off, you know, and just look at the target and keep heading to that.
The basic preparation for ultramarathon is how long can you sustain on your legs. So very important is to strengthen your legs, because you are there on your legs for longer period, 10 hours, 15 hours, 20 hours, 30 hours, whatever. So that recovery plays a very important role. Power naps plays a very important role. How you can recover back after taking a 15 minutes nap and then you come back on the road again. How strong can you be mentally? Because after a particular time, your body gives up. And then your mental, everything is about the mental game. When I did 72, a friend of mine I was talking to, and she said there are 111, 112, 113 events also. And that's the time my reaction was, how can somebody run so many kilometers? But then I tried, if I'd done 72, why not I do 111? I must attempt for it at least. When I did 111 kilometers, I did well. But I waited back. I wanted to meet these guys, because how can somebody run 222 and 333? So when I waited at the function, the organizer was talking about 111 as a baby run, you know, and then those guys were talking about their experiences. I said, this is not done. I must come back again for higher version of triple one. And I said, why not opt for triple three now? So at the function of triple one, I decided to opt for triple three. It was decided that time. This is La Ultra. It is the cruelest marathon in the world, and that gives me a kick. Like, you know, I'm a participant of the cruelest marathon in the world. My approach was I wanted to be at the start line as a strong athlete. I was not worried about what happens, whether I will be able to finish, what will happen to me, because in Himalaya, anything can happen. The weather conditions can go haywire. Oxygen levels are less, so anything can happen to you at any given time. So I was not worried. I was very, very positive with triple three. First 87 just went off very well. Then I reached South Pulu, where the crew members were waiting for me. And I was in a good shape that time, perfectly. Everything was going as per the time.
Everything on our mind was to keep him awake, keep talking to him, keep feeding him, to see to it that whether he takes the liquid in time and whether he is not overrunning, whether he is not overspeeding, and at the same time he is not oversleeping or overresting. We were just seeing that his clock is moving in the right time, is feeding right, and keep him moving.
And then the crew, one of my friend was with me as my pacer, and then we started running towards Leh. So we finished triple one in a good zone. Triple one, you don't have to rest because the race starts and then you finish it in 20 hours. So you don't have to take rest anywhere. So after triple one, your body is already tired. And then you need to push yourself again for 24 hours and 24 hours. So mentally also you are strong because you're not sleeping also well. But somehow we could do Varila also pretty good. Up to triple two, I was in a perfectly good shape. I was doing very well. So after finishing triple two, my idea was to take a rest for some time. The race director, Mark Woolley, is a veteran runner. He came to me and he said, if you take a rest now, you'll be out of the race. You can't take a rest like this. You have to be on the road. Race director is saying like this. So again, I got up, I wore my shoes. There were blisters on my feet, so it was very difficult to move also. That time, I was a little angry also with him, maybe, but I don't know. There was no reaction as such. Since my brother was also with me and there was a mobile network there. So he called my mother. And my mother is not into running and she doesn't like me running at all, such long distances. So she came on the line and said, hey Ashish, you've already done 222. So now just 100, which you do it every month. So pay attention here. So to tumhara regular hai. I said, wow. But that gave me a good boost, you know, because then I said, 100 to main regularly karta hun. When we started, it was difficult to move, feeling very sleepy. When I got onto the main road, I took a nap for 15 minutes and then again got fresh. Little bit of hallucination on the way. So there were a lot of things happening. Reached Lato, which is the last cutoff station, and I started. Started fresh in the morning. It was about 6:30, 7 o'clock in the morning. So I was fresh. There were three guys ahead of me. So I started very early, very early. In another 1 hour's time, I got hold of the third guy. I overtook him, I went ahead. So Tanglangla was my last challenge and I was doing very well.
Also the last pass of 333. Just finished just 14 kilometers away.
And I had 4 hours to go down 20 kilometers and finish the race. That particular time, we started getting the organizers' vehicles, the crew members and the medical, the ambulance, they started coming in. And then there was a discussion whether Ashish reaches on time at 2:45, he will do it. If he reaches at 3, then there's a possibility that he may not do it. So all those negative things, it starts playing in your mind. It's about 3 o'clock, I must have started going down. And the race final cutoff was 6 o'clock. I was running for, I didn't know the time distance, but I was running for about 1.5 hours. So I managed, must have done a good amount of kilometers. So I asked one of the organizers, how many kilometers to go? Because there was no marking anywhere. That fellow said 17 kilometers. When he said 17 kilometers, then I said, there's something wrong. This guy is not saying the right thing. There's something wrong. And slowly, I went a little ahead, but my pace slowed down. then this my thought got stuck in my mind that I have completed my race and these guys, they want to have a special finish and that's why they're making me run. One particular time, I stopped completely. This was just 2 kilometers away from the finish line.
It was horrifying. And we couldn't push him. He would have been out of the race. Doctors were out there to declare him medically unfit to continue. And we were convincing, check his BP, check his pulse, and he's all right.
Then I told him, I said, doctor, this is stupid questions. I said, I'm in a good shape. I know what is happening. But you are also part of the team. You want to make a strong finish, and that's why you're making me run.
At that 14,000-15,000 altitude, Ashish behaving like that, Ashish telling me that there is a drum, I'm going to sit there and I'm not going to come out.
Because at one point I called the crew, my crew vehicle. I told him, I told the driver, let's go back. So they were worried because if I had to sit in the vehicle, everything would have been over after 332 kilometers. So they were emotional, but at the same time they had to be very careful because something goes wrong medically, it can be disastrous. Luckily, after about 500 meters, one young boy, the organizer's son, one Australian doctor, and 2 years back, there was a roommate of mine. So these three guys came. One guy came with the Indian flag. They started talking. They said, Ashish, we just have to go here. We take this turn and then there's a finish and all. I said, now you guys, there are new faces. Now I said, now for you all, only this turn. Now, but once I finish with this turn, I'm not going to run.
Come on, Ashish, come on.
Come on, 1 minute, 7 seconds left. What a milestone for him. And for all those who have accompanied him from Pune.
Come on! 35 seconds!
He's good. Yay! We were practically in tears because we were in heaven that point of time, time would should stand still.
So I had a dramatic finish, like the final cutoff time was 72 hours. I finished it in 71 hours, 59 minutes, 29 seconds. So just 31 seconds prior. And that's a special finish for any ultra. My dream is when you see an athlete, he gets a gold medal or any medal, bronze medal or silver medal, and he sees that national flag going up. If you see his eyes, you see the entire his journey. You can see that because that those eyes are with everything. You have the hard work, everything. I'm the third Indian to finish it. That's a great feeling.
Immediately after finishing, people started asking, like, what next?
Yeah, running 555 anywhere, even let it be at sea level, it's always going to be crazy. But what he's attempting at that altitude, there are no words to describe how crazy it is.
People call me mad actually, and I just love that because I strongly believe when people call you mad, that means you're on the right track. You're doing something good for yourself. 132 hours you have to finish 555 kilometers. So basically, I'll call it the 6 nights, 5.5 days package. 13 people in the world are eligible to participate, and I'm one of them. If I'm eligible, then why can't I? I should be there as a starting lineup with all the hard work, right?
The 333 and 555, their motto line is put in your best. It will be dishonoring the race and anyone or to say, no, it's, he can do it. It's not that easy. No one can say this. But Ashish will prepare very well, I know for sure. luck should be on his side.
I started dreaming about it now already, how it will be, and so I just want to finish strong this time. That's my idea. I should know I'm finishing it. That is my target. And I always believe, you know, you're not born to just pay light bills and telephone bills. Because if I just come in this live world and then do nothing and then die, everybody has to die. But then if I don't do anything, that's no value. So that is what my aim in life is. And I, at the end of the day, I should feel nice about myself. That, you know, this guy has got something. I have punch in my life. And that's why I strongly believe in it.